Well, let's go ahead and get started. Welcome to our December EAA 292 meeting. As you all know, this is very unusual. We would normally be having our holiday party today or tonight, and obviously under the conditions, that's not happening. So thanks again for everyone being really, really patient and tolerant. And I think we got a really good program again for the members today. And I'm just kind of going to go through, we'll talk again for those who are new to doing these video meetings. We'll kind of go through some of the etiquette. We'll run through a few of the chapter reports. Mike Short, are you on? I didn't see if you're on yet.
Mike, yes, I am.
Okay, good. Mike will cover a little bit on the safety corner. We've got just a brief outtake from the EAA National video chapter, Graham. A little bit about what we want to do next year, newsletter, some of the projects, upcoming programs, and then we'll have Jan and Alissa, speaking. And that's going to be kind of supplemented by Jerry Price. So it's going to be a tag team effort. And then finally, if we have any extra time, which it turns out we haven't, except for our very first meeting, we've got some hints for home builders that continue to accumulate. And with that, let's kind of go into the meeting and etiquette. Most of you guys have been with us now. And so the do's are, if you're not speaking, please use your mute button, because what happens is sound comes out of the speaker, goes into your microphone, and we end up getting an echo. So at the same time, we do want everyone to be able to feel this is not a one-way presentation. We want you to feel free to ask questions. I hesitate to say interrupt, but in fact, we do want it to be a two-way street. So do let others finish before speaking. And the analogy we always use, you're flying in the pattern. You kind of got to wait to get your radio call in. So please wait until the speaker before you finishes, key your mic and have at it. So we'll do the best we can trying to work everybody in. And by the way, if I detect that we're getting a lot of noise or background or whatever, I do have the ability on this end to mute you, and so don't be offended if I do that. I've got already a couple people muted because noise was coming in. So if you want to speak up, just unmute, say your piece, and then please remute. We also have a chat window if you want and you don't want to speak up. Type your question in the chat window, and Steve, I'm going to ask you, if you don't mind, to keep an eye on that and to interrupt me if we have questions coming in or comments coming in that I'm not able to address.
Got it.
Thank you. Everybody knows this, but I think we're getting really, really good at it. We've been trying to encourage people to use a wired connection rather than Wi-Fi, although the Wi-Fi nowadays is getting much, much better. And again, the chapter, the board met yesterday. We're doing everything we can during this trying period to bring as much value to our members as we can. We're doing our best. So please bear with us. And we always ask if something comes up during the meeting, please, we'd like for you to, whether you write up something or contact Rich Harrison, for our newsletter. We're really, really happy with our newsletter. We're getting lots and lots of positive comments. So if you've got something you want to put in it, and by the way, that includes if you have something that you would like to sell. We haven't done a lot of this recently, but yeah, there is an opportunity. If you have a couple things or tools or something that you would like to move along, please send them along to Rich, and we'll try to get those included. I'm not going to cover the don'ts today, but some of them go pretty obvious. And we did some of these tongue in cheeks. Don't call from your airplane. Don't start your engine. Don't discuss the FARs that you violated. Don't be in the bathroom. so forth and so on. So with that, I'm going to come back to jumping around here, getting to our reports, secretary and treasury reports. I don't know if Rich is on the line. Steve, do you want to go ahead and handle the membership and budget? I'm sorry, John. If John's on with us.
Yeah, I'm right here. I'm pulling this stuff together as we speak. So anyway, our membership's coming up. A bunch of people have paid by PayPal. It'd be great if more people got on there and paid. We've got a special way of the extra dollar we charge for PayPal if you pay it by the end of the year.
Hey, Vince, are you ready to cover facilities?
Yeah, go ahead.
You want me to go ahead?
No, not a whole lot with facilities. I have a couple things I'll bring up. The Powermatic drill press was kind of down for a bit. We have a new chuck on the thing. I would please ask that if you're going to use that, if you can't get it tight enough to keep your drill from spinning with your hands, go use a different drill press. Please don't use a pipe wrench on it. That's kind of what happened to it to begin with, and it doesn't really do them much good. So that's up and running. Facility otherwise, I think everything is okay. I see some a few empty hooks on the tools hanging in the walls. There's a couple wrenches missing. Let's try and get those back if we can. I'd hate to see those slowly drift away. We are talking about getting someone to clean the meeting room and the kitchen and the bathrooms. I've got a quote coming next week for that, so that we can kind of keep this place a little. I think with this COVID thing, it's important that we keep this place a bit cleaner. But this person will not be cleaning in the work spaces. That's the responsibility of the individual people who are working in those spaces. So keep your space clean. Use the garbage cans. We'll haul the junk off. And I think that'll help a lot. Also, the tools that are around, if you use common tools, kind of clean those up also. I think that's about all I have. Mike, was there anything else that we were talking about?
No, I think you got it covered. And I just want to say thank you to everyone who is respecting the COVID rules about keeping your mask, wearing your masks, you know, doing all the things that just make common sense. So thanks again. By doing this, we're able to keep our clubhouse open and working. And, you know, we just hope that we'll be through this soon. So, Vince, I will pull up your pictures when we get around to chapter projects, if that's okay. I'll take that as a yes.
Yeah, that's fine.
Dave, you want to give us an update? Anything you want to talk about in youth?
Let me unmute here. I'll do youth and I'll do other airplanes all at the same time. Is that okay?
Sure.
Okay. On the youth, we've decided to seriously talk about doing the Youth Aviation Weekend in January. We're going to talk about it. You know, just depends on how this COVID stuff shakes out. The same goes. We're playing the June Young Eagles by ear also. Again, just depending on how things go. The 701 aircraft, which the youth built, has now flown, thanks to Bill McLaughlin and Henry Bartle also chipping in there. It's got 3 or 4 hours on it. It's got one electrical problem that's down at the moment, but typical berthing things. If you're interested in a 701 with a really nice engine in it, speak to either Bill McLaughlin or myself or Henry Bartle. You can spec the paint job and make it as beautiful as you want it, because right now it's bare metal. It's a really nice airplane. Again, if you want more information, speak to Bill or me. I think that's all on youth, unless Al wants to chime in on what's happening on the Saturday. Not hearing Al, I'll continue on another airplane. As you may be aware, the Lance Air that we're rebuilding, it's hit another glitch. You might remember the story that it was donated to the club. We sold it to Ken Elmenhurst on a deal where he would put some money into it and we'd finish it for him and he'd get a really good deal. Unfortunately, Ken passed away. We then resold it to Ron Korf in Colorado. And I just heard 2 weeks ago that Ron has passed away. A very strange thing is each time this occurs, we actually make more money on this airplane. The joke that's going around is that Lance Airs kill people. This one kills people on the ground without
terrible
ever getting
joke.
Finished.
Terrible joke,
it's a
Dave.
Terrible joke. I knew you'd hate that. But the good news is that this airplane's going to get finished. It's all the estate is working with us to get the airplane finished. The really good news is somebody's going to end up with a really nice airplane. If you're at all interested in a Lance Air 4P at a good price, where you get to spec the paint job, you get to spec the interior, you get to spec all the amenities, speak to Henry, Mike, or myself. This is your opportunity to own one at a price that may be as much as $100,000 less than they're currently going for. So if you want a good cross-country airplane, here's your opportunity. I think that's all I've got, Mike.
All right. Thank you. I'm going to come back around when we get to projects. I'm going to ask Bill for an update about the flight of the 701. But Debbie Orger is not on. As you saw a little while ago, we have some funds. We are kind of one of the unique chapters. We actually have three candidates flying under the Ray Scholarship Program now. We have Anders, we have Kristen, and we have Zach, which is pretty incredible. And everyone's moving along and spending the money. Fortunately, again, this is all being funded out of EAA National. So when you see those dollars in our account, those are really set aside and those are EA National dollars, but they've been assigned to us. Mike, you want to go ahead and talk about the WINGS program?
Sure. Welcome, everybody. This Wednesday at 5:30 Pacific Standard Time, there's a webinar about the FAA WINGS safety program. It's kind of just a refresher on it and talks about how it works and some of the benefits you get and how to sign in, sign out, and get your credits and all that. So I thought I'd bring that up. Also, yesterday I got an email from Avemco, and Avemco is offering 5% off on your insurance premium if you complete a WINGS level. And also, of course, WINGS level also applies to your flight review every 2 years. So there's some benefits there for WINGS, not to mention proficiency and, kind of going back and practicing some of those old private pilot maneuvers or commercial maneuvers, whatever you're rated for, kind of get you back into the groove again, especially after the winter here when we're not flying much because of the fog and the rain. So, but I thought I'd bring that up. 5% is pretty substantial, especially on some people's policies who have expensive airplanes. So, and that is December 16th at 5:30 p.m. You just go to faasafety.gov, the website there, and you can get signed into that. So also don't forget about VMC and INC clubs every first Monday of the month at 7 p.m., you should get an email through the chapter that gives you a link for those. We've been having a lot of fun with those. We've been averaging around 30 people each month and had some great participation. So just wanted to remind people about VMC and IMC Club. So that's about all I have,
Mike. Thanks, Mike. Thanks. And by the way, people don't know what that link is, but if you simply put in your search engine, Google or what have you, Fast Wings and FAAST Wings, and it'll take you right to the website. If you haven't registered, you can register, sign up. There's a lot of materials there, things that you can do on your own or things that you can participate in from a webinar or a workshop series. So be aware, there's some good materials out there and just Google it. Okay, I'm going to play a little video here from Charlie Becker just to kind of give you some things that are going on at National, and hopefully this will pull up.
Now, coming up in December, we always have our Wright Brothers Memorial Banquet. And because of not having any events at the museum right now, we are doing this as a live stream. So the good news for you is any EA member can tune into the live stream on December 10th at 7 p.m. Central. And it's going to be none other than EA member Captain Jim Lovell talking about his Apollo and Gemini mission. So should be great, great programming. Much better than whatever's going on the TV, I'm sure. So definitely tune into that. All you have to do is go to EA.org/Wright Brothers and log in and as an EA member, and you'll be able to watch that. Now, we have a new offering as part of our webinar series, and that's the museum webinar series. And this will be the second Tuesday of the month. The first one kicks off in January 12th. And that is going to be focused on our Huey aircraft that we just acquired. It's a new exhibit in the museum. And it's going to be called Huey, Saving a Workhorse from Vietnam. So all of these museum webinar series are going to do a bit of a deep dive around one of our historic aircraft that are in our collection. So I think it's going to be really cool, a great way to learn more about those aircraft that have been donated over the years. And in February, it will be around the Corsair. So make sure you sign up for that. Also coming up in January, we have Home Builders Week. Again, new offering. Focused 100% on home building content. It's going to be starting on January 26th, which is, just happens to be the 68th anniversary of the founding of EAA. It'll be 5 forums a day for 5 days. We now have 4 sponsors in place to help us pull that off. So I want to give a big thank you to Aircraft Spruce and Specialty, Vans Aircraft, Skeen Designers, and Dynon Avionics. So thank you for supporting our efforts to pull off Home Builders Week. It's going to be great. I'd encourage you to go look at the schedule. We've got some great topics that will appeal to really anyone that's a home builder, no matter where they are in the process, either just getting started or even if you're close to finishing. There's definitely some presentations that are going to be of value to you. So that's all I wanted to share. I want to, just from all of us here at EAA, I want to wish everyone a Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays from EAA. Stay safe, and let's make sure that 2021 is an excellent year for aviation.
And just following on that, that Home Builders Week looks pretty interesting. Since a lot of us don't have any place to go, we may put out an additional little bulletin or newsletter to our chapter members, because it looks like there's going to be great content that whole week of January while we're kind of landlocked and weatherlocked here up in the great Northwest. So just something to mark on your calendars. They didn't say it, but everything is going ahead full speed for planning Air Venture in 2021. So, I mean, everyone is making an assumption that things are going to be, the calendars are going to be released. We're going to, you know, get back to some type of new normal. We're going to be having events. And that actually affects us here at 292 as well. I think our first official event would be in June, which would be Young Eagles. We have our fly-in in August. We have some other things that are, you know, happening throughout the year. These activities actually all require planning. So probably what we're going to do, maybe in the January timeframe, it's been suggested that we start putting together even a video planning meeting to start talking about these, especially the fly-in. And whether we do a full-up fly-in, whether we do a fly-in light, as was suggested by Bruce, we have to evaluate what we want to do, what we might be capable of doing. But just be aware, we're going to start looking for volunteers and ideas as we start thinking positively about next summer. Rich isn't on the phone. However, again, he's asking for anyone who has newsletter content, a flight that they took someplace that they'd be happy to write up, something that they're doing with their project, a new tool that they've discovered, something else that they'd like to share, especially if you have a couple of photos, please send it to Rich. And ideally, he'd be looking for that content before December 20th. It's always the 20th of the month so we can get the newsletter put together. Everybody's really, really happy with the newsletter. So I just want to, the reason that it's successful is we have great crowdsourced content, and we need to kind of keep that up. Chapter projects. We already covered a little bit about this, but I'm going to jump on to two other, I'm going to ask Bill McLagan to unmute and maybe talk about the first flight or first several flights of the 701, the Youth Build 701 that we just completed. So, Bill, are you out there? Can you kind of tell us what happened with your flights?
Well, a little history just to get started. The project was donated by Joe Zaworski about 5 years ago, and the youth started working on it 4 years ago. And a year ago, it was ready except for the cowl, and we eventually got the cowl in September, and Henry and I, mostly Henry, finished it. And so a week ago, we got our airworthiness certificate. So a week ago today, I went for the first flight. It's probably memorable because, as it turns out, during some of the taxi tests, I noticed that it was really kind of twitchy on control on the ground, particularly when you had full power, but really wasn't expecting what I got. And what I got was quite a significant swerve to the right on liftoff. And then it kind of got ahead of me. We had about three or four cycles of pilot-induced oscillation until I finally got a hold of it. And that was the interesting part. Went up, did normal, did stalls, came back and landed a little bit like a carrier landing because I wasn't that familiar with it. But anyway, it's all the engine ran fine. And other than my little flopping around the sky at the very beginning, it was great. We've had three other flights on it, exploring the stall characteristics, exploring flaps. It flies straight and level. No trim, major trims things have to be done, but it is a very sensitive airplane. It's also almost impossible to stall. I've never got it a break yet, and I've had it as far as I can other than a full cross control stall. So for someone who learns how to fly it, it's going to be a fun airplane.
Great. Thanks, Bill. Appreciate that. Vince, do you have a, and by the way, we're going to be flying that plane, probably fly off the hours and then putting it up for sale. So if someone is interested in pursuing that, you know, please contact Bill or myself or any of the other board members. We'd be happy to work with you. Actually, we'd probably be happy to work with you in flying off the hours because we're going to be looking to figure out how to do that between now and then. Vince, you want to talk about your project now? I'm going to put up your picture.
Yeah, I already have too many real airplanes, so I'm making fake ones. This is another mock-up that I'm building. I've got a P-39 that I built a long time ago. A couple of years ago or a year ago, I built an ME-262 subscale and decided that a really interesting airplane was a B-25. So this is a half-scale B-25, and it's coming along. What I plan on doing is covering one half of it and leaving the other half open. It's built back to the leading edge of the wing so that I could put in a tandem two-place arrangement in the thing. There's a couple more pictures there. There's the inside with the panel. It's got a B-25 yoke in it. Fake panel, all that kind of stuff. Hey, fun project. I like making these things. They're really interesting to you see how you fit in the things. Subscale airplanes are really difficult because things like windows, things like that get small. The guy who built the B-17, the one-third scale B-17, he did a tremendous job on that except for one little thing, and that is he made the cockpit windows bigger and scale so that you could see better out of them, and it just really stood out. It's like, oh, that's not right kind of thing. This thing is dimensionally scaled at 50%. I didn't have to change much of anything. So if anybody wants to see it, drop by. Got a nose gear in it that works and all that good stuff. So, you know, fun project.
Thanks, Vince. Appreciate that.
Yeah, let me make a comment. This is Dave. The unfortunate part is Vince and I are thinking of turning that into a real airplane.
If the builders group wants to finance something, the problem is the engine and props for the thing are a major hit. So that's the big stumbling block.
Thanks, guys. Hey, moving along here, you got an update on the Lance Air. Just be aware, we have a completely ready-to-fly pterodactyl ultralight, and we'd really, really like to find a chapter member that would be interested in purchasing that. And I think Henry and Arrow would be interested in getting it out of their hangar because it's a pretty mammoth contraption. But anyway, contact Jerry Price or Ernie Marino, either one, and you can go see it, sit in it. It's a fascinating mechanism. And for somebody who wants to do low and slow, it'd be an awesome way of getting into it, you know, without, and I underscore without, a pilot license. And we still have a couple of RV6s in various stages of constructions or kits. And those are still being offered. We are probably not going to finish them. So we would offer them up as is. And again, contact, probably Jerry Price would be the best contact for that. All right, we're moving along into our programs. As we already mentioned, this month, we've got Jan and Alissa talking about Viking. Next month, we're going to have a really interesting program. I had the opportunity of going out and visiting with Dwight Hoover. Out at his build shop, which is slash his garage or his workshop. And he took the 701 that was donated to us. I should say he bought the 701 that was donated to us by the Pearson Museum and put it together and now is putting the Yamaha Apex on it. And never having been done, he's kind of going through all the learning of what has, you know, what has to be built, what has to be manufactured. And so the presentation is going to be twofold. It's going to be a lot about the Apex, and it'll be probably a little bit less about the 701, since we all know what one of those is. But we're looking forward to that. In February, we've got Lightspeed coming in, since they're local up here, up the road a little bit. And to be scheduled right now is Hummel, Afford-A-Plane, and Cub Crafters. We're discussing with all of them and trying to figure out dates. And so with that, Jerry, Jan, and Alissa, I'm going to ask you guys to unmute your mics, and I'm going to put up a first slide here, Jerry. Why don't you do the introduction?
Well, thank you. I want to extend thanks to Jan and Alissa for making themselves available for this this presentation. They're going to be talking about the Viking engine, the three popular types that they have currently, and this information is all taken off of their website, so you don't need to take any screen pictures. This is all stuff I pirated from Alyssa's work on the site, which looks quite nice. But the three basic engines are, they've got a 90 horsepower, which is derived from 2019, 2020 Mitsubishi Mirage. The 130, which is also, it's a 2019, 2020 1.5 liter Honda Fit. This is, from what I've been able to gather talking with them and doing some research on my own, one of their most popular engines right now. And then they also have a 195 horse turbo engine that's derived from 2019 to 20, 1.5 liter turbocharged Honda Accord engine. So all of the stuff they're putting out, it's not stuff that's coming out of a junkyard. This is all new technology, and that'll be explained a little bit in the video we're going to show. But this is top notch. You're not buying 1930s technology as the traditional legacy engines are. And with that, if you don't mind, Mike,
I'll go back to the video. Hey, I want to interject here, because before the meeting, we do have a chapter member who's online with us right now, Rich Paulson, who purchased a Viking prior to the 130. They offered a 110, and he is currently installing that on his RV12 and has offered up to, if anybody wants to see it, talk about it. It's not flying yet, but that would be something, Jerry, we might want to do a follow on, because I'd be curious about how that whole project's coming along.
Excellent.
All right. So as Jerry alluded to, there's a process on how Viking actually acquires these engines. And Alyssa's going to take us through it here. And fortunately, they just did some video interviews with, for Engine Week. And I think it's going to be pretty interesting. Guess who?
Hey, get out of the shot.
So it's Engine Week, and today we stop off at Viking Aircraft Engines to give you a quick tour.
Hi.
Where does everything start?
Yeah, sure. We'll go over every little aspect of that. But the first thing that I have to do is we have a vendor that we source our engines through. So essentially, we have a certain number of specifications that we want, which means low mileage, new year, no damage, as perfect as we can get it. And I get pictures sent to me. We look those over. They arrive here at the shop, and then we obviously go over the engine itself and approve it or don't approve it, and then we move on from there.
There's not a fresh pallet that just arrived today to be able to capture that, but they do come on pallets.
Yes.
And then from there, what do you guys do? Do you clean it? What do you do from the pallet stage?
First, we do a visual inspection on everything, and then we take it on over, make sure the VIN matches, the information that we had. And then it goes on over to Sal, who works on the engine, and there's a bunch of parts and pieces that kind of get taken off that just belong to the car itself, from the old harness. We just get rid of all that stuff, and then we replace it with our own. The engine itself stays exactly the same, so the internals are exactly what Honda did. We add our external pieces, our wiring harness, our computer, everything that makes it a Viking engine. And something that's really important, and our customers always have a lot of questions about, is the VIN number. Something that's really great about these engines is we get them in, and the VIN number is right on the side of the vehicle, right in the side of the engine, not the vehicle. But you can see it down here, it shows it, and then you can take this VIN number right here, specifically from Honda, and then you can see exactly what happened to your engine, and that this had 8 or 9 miles on it, and there was shipping damage, and that's how we received this engine. So you essentially get the latest technology at a lower price, and you know exactly where your engine came from.
Okay, so after you check the engines in, inspect, verify VIN number and all that stuff, what's the very next step on the build process?
Well, the next step is to take the engine and just kind of break it down into, remove the intake manifold, remove any old parts, or anything that's not going to be reused, and also parts that are going to be reused but might have to be modified. One thing will be like an intake manifold. Comes off the engine, put aside. Exhaust, off the engine, put aside. And then when we can either then rebuild these pieces and put them back on the engine right away, or more commonly, these then become sub-assemblies. We might do 20 intake manifolds. We might do 20 wire looms that go on the engine. As far as the wire loom, very little is reused. Sometimes connectors, or the shells, they're called. Special tools are used to remove them from the harness. And then our technician, Sal, will then string Tefcel wiring, aviation wiring, onto this board. We have different boards for different engines. Of course, the 90, 100, 130, and the 190 engine all have different wiring boards. And then new pins in some instances, and reused shells in some instances, are then wired onto it. At the end of the harness is, of course, the big connectors that go into the ECU that kind of operate the whole works. And that's one thing that we do have that's different than the car, and that is the ECU or the electronic control unit. Each engine goes through a dyno process where the spark timing, the cam timing, fuel injection pulse width, all those things are programmed for the engine so that it becomes the Viking engine at the end. Other parts that are made as far as sub-assemblies are flywheels, the gearbox, some muffler parts, propeller hubs, obviously, they're all forged, and you have to put in the bushings. And so there's a lot of little things that get done. Gears get unpacked from their shipping containers, and then sub-assemblies of gearboxes are put together, the front housing, the rear housing, and then complete gearboxes are made up, and then gearboxes are then eventually installed on the engine after the flywheel and the coupling system is installed. So there's a little bit of this, a little bit of that. Let's tour the shop a little bit, and I can show you some of the pieces.
All right, to back up just a moment, you mentioned earlier you do some modifications to the intake and throttle body. Explain what goes on there.
Well, the important part, of course, is like what Alissa was talking about, is there are no internal changes to the engine. We want everybody to understand that the robotically put together Honda engine that you would get in your Civic when you went to the dealership is still what you're going to get. There are some things that won't fit in an airplane, like this manifold is in the car. It kind of curves up on top of the engine like this. Of course, you want to get as low of a profile as we can. So that has been rotated around the other way, and an adapter is made to do that. As far as back to the sub-assembly parts, for instance, 20 of these are just made up. So these are the original throttle bodies, but we don't use the electronic throttle that you have in the car. So a little bit of machining is done in here, and then whatever needs to be done to it, the idle screw and so forth, are all pre-done and then put in the box, and then we do like 10, maybe 15 sub-assemblies, and then we get back to assembling the engine. Further sub-assemblies, it might not look like much, but you would find an alternator like this on maybe a John Deere tractor, and a list price could be like $600-$700. Now, of course, we're not after buying those kinds of expensive parts for your engine. We want that quality, but we have to source. So Viking has their own part number with Nip and Denso, which is the genuine version of this alternator. You can tell by the ceramic coating in here, as well as some other things on the alternator, of course, the Nip and Denso embossed emblem. We then machine, or have machined, because we're not a machine shop. We are a design and an engine building shop. A pulley for it that corresponds to our serpentine belt. And that's the alternator that then is prepped, as in every mounting bracket or screw that it needs is done, and then they're put back in the box and ready to go for final assembly of the engine. Same with the starters. Starters are the same starter that came in with the low mileage engine, so you end up with a Honda starter. Not much that's done to it other than making sure that it is a good product that can then be used on an airplane engine. And it is, of course, the original starter and not an aftermarket or low budget starter. I think one thing that is kind of neat for the customer, most people in today's world believe in their car engine, and most people have realized that, why is my car so reliable? It didn't used to be. I had to go like get tune-ups and all that, and there's a lot of reasons for that. One of them being the ignition system, and that might be one place where we get a little flack, especially from like old school diehard aviation guys that are like, you know, if it doesn't have two plugs, it shouldn't be in the air type of thing. But you know, it's so easy to say stuff like that without truly understanding what's behind it. The engine does have, in fact, lots of different ways where it can stay running. It doesn't have like one carburetor. It has basically four, because it's got four injectors. It doesn't have one way of firing the spark plug. It has four. It has four drivers in the computers. It's got four plugs. It's got, and again, the plugs are not the old plugs. They're iridium platinum plugs. So right away, we're like, tripling the lifetime and the reliability of the old school plugs. So it's very easy to make generalizations that in today's world, they don't hold true anymore. This is what the coil looks like. You know, like it used to be a distributor, and then you had long wires going to your spark plugs. The wires are actually kind of like a maintenance item. So automotive designers and technicians and people that are designing these engines say, well, how can we eliminate failure points? You know, just like aviation, they also don't want failure points because cars, they want to sell their cars. They don't want to have problems with their cars. They don't want consumer reports to say, well, your car is a lemon. They want to be able to sell them. So what they did is they eliminated the wires. They put the coil right on top of the spark plug. There's power and ground to each one. And the actual amount of juice that it takes to fire the coil is just a couple of milliamps on a signal wire that fires the coil at the proper time, you know, without these big wires and things like that that are all over the engine. So there's a lot of little details that you should not overlook about modern Honda engines versus even engines that were made 10 years ago in cars or airplanes. So now after the engine's been assembled, we take it over to our test cart. We don't run every engine with a propeller because it doesn't really prove too much about this type of engine. This type of engine can run without a propeller, just like it ran without a propeller in a car. What is a little bit different, or what is similar to other test stands, is that we do have power and a fuel pump and an alternator, and we can read a few things manually. We obviously have a battery to start it, and we have some fuel. We have like a little octopus here where we can plug into different types of engines depending on which size connector. So that's already set up and ready to go. Same with the main, like different starters for different engines and your main power and your ground and so forth. So very adaptable to different engines. ECU, and this is where we're getting away from the traditional and more into a computer controlled engine, is that we then plug the engine into our laptop, get our software going, and then that's mostly what is being checked during the run, making sure the cams are actually moving, because they are variable cams, that we have proper fuel flow, that the temperature sensors are actually operating through their full range and things like that. So that's mostly what's important to check, in addition to, of course, making sure that the gearbox is running cool and the engine is running cool and things like that, that the alternator is putting out current. So some of the traditional stuff and some that are a little bit different. Power and the key.
So, Jerry, you're back on.
Okay. So now we'll just cover some very basic specifications of the Viking engine series. And there's a lot more detail on the website, and we'll have a link at the end that shows you. You can take a look and do more research at your leisure. The Viking 90, the things that are interesting about these, at least to me, I think there's a little bit of a mindset that if you take a water-cooled engine, you know, this type of automotive engine that isn't all stripped down. Granted, they've made changes to specialize it to an aircraft, but my mindset was these things have got to be heavy and maybe bulky. But take a look at some of these specs. The Viking 90, 90 horsepower at 5,800 RPM. Of course, we're going through a reduction unit. A weight of 159 pounds, very comparable to engines alike horsepower out there. Gives the gearbox ratio there, typical takeoff RPM at the engine of 4,800, but with the gearbox, it brings it down to a nice propeller RPM of 2,500. And then at cruise, you would expect to do somewhere in the neighborhood of 4,500 engine RPM and only have 2,000 propeller, making it very efficient. And also some specs here for if you choose to do something like this, using it in a STOL type aircraft, running 5,800 RPM, getting your prop up to 2,500. And the Eggenfellners will probably be able to address a lot more succinctly the advantages. We'll talk a little bit about a variable prop or just give an intro to it. But what that allows you in terms of RPM and generating horsepower or pulling it back to where you can really have optimum and low fuel flow. The engine will run on 93 octane minimum, and look at the dimensions of it. 22 length, height of 25, and a width of 19. If you go to the next slide, Mike. And here you can see it applied, probably easier to see than to think about. And on to the next one will be a further breakdown of it, and only 17 inches wide. All right, on to the next engine, the 130. Okay, so the 130, which appears to be their most popular at this point, only 1.5 liters, but they've really got these engines running, Honda does, generating a lot of horsepower for displacement. I can remember, I'm probably older than a lot of, maybe some of the folks that are watching this, but I can remember having a 2-liter Chevy Love, and don't tease me on that too much, but 2 liters back in 74, 75 generated only 75 horsepower. So this, we're using more RPM. The weight of the Viking 130, 220 pounds. Very comparable to, well, in fact, puts a little bit more horsepower, but very comparable to, say, Corvair, which is somewhere in the neighborhood of 220 to 225. Once again, using a gearbox reduction of 2.33. And we've got some specs here on takeoff RPMs and what you get at the prop, but you can see where the engine is running at an efficient RPM, but yet we're not looking at tip speeds that are going to make the prop inefficient. All these engines will run on, well, this will run on 100 low lead. There is a spec you'll see on the website that indicates you'll run Decalin to prevent lead buildup. And once again, length, height, and width of the engine. And I think we've got one more there that'll show kind of a breakdown of how it looks. And I think Jan or Alissa, jump in. This is, you've indicated that's the most popular. A lot of these are going into, looks like 701, 750s. Is that correct?
Yeah, and I wanted just to elaborate a little bit more there as far as the fuel, just because it wasn't noted there, that sure. Mostly what you want to use is the auto fuel. Higher sure. Grade, obviously, if possible, it has a longer shelf life. But auto fuel is really what you want to use. But you also use 100 low lead with an additive, especially when you're doing cross countries, that auto fuel isn't always available. But yeah, the 130 is, as we call it, our bread and butter engine. You know, we have them on kit boxes and Highlanders and a lot of odd and end airplanes and powered parachutes. But our main customer seems to be, because they have a very open platform where the builder can kind of choose whatever they want. They don't feel as if they're kind of pushed into a general direction on what engine they have to choose. And we supply everything for it. So it makes that, you know, option really nice. And given it has a gearbox and it's able to put out over 600 pounds of thrust, it winds up working really, really well for a STOL type environment. So it pretty much maxes out that airplane as far as horsepower. The installed weight does wind up being similar. And we've done a few swaps where we've taken out 0200s and Corvairs. And they wind up being almost the same exact installed weight. Granted, there's 30 more horsepower, so, and a lot more thrust. So it winds up being a big winner for that airplane as well.
Thank you. Next slide, Mike, will show one installed on a particular aircraft. So you can see what a compact design it is. And I would, tagging on to what Alissa said, what I've cut and put on these slides was just a little bit of the info. I didn't want to flood you guys with too much to look at, but on their website, it's got a complete breakdown of oil pressures, coolant specs, specified fuel, and so forth. And here Mike is bringing up the website, give you a kind of a preview. And I think I had one more slide on 130 just hanging out open on the front of an aircraft. Nice, clean looking installation. And then there's the Viking 195 turbocharged. And I think this is, it looks like, at least what I've been able to see, the favorite application for this has been the Stoll type aircraft, the larger Zeniths. A lot of horsepower, of course, an increase in weight, but still pretty competitive at 260 pounds. Obviously, you're not going to hang that on the front of one of our real light experimentals, but it'll cross over very nicely in replacing some other type engines. And same type thing on the fuel. We've got some specs here on length, height, and width, and still taking a look at this, looking at the width of the engine, still very narrow, fits into a cowling very nicely. And then there's another one actually showing the front of the engine, the next slide that'll show you the turbo and so forth. All right. One of the things that is nice about the Viking engine series is that you're not just shipped. You purchase one of these engines. You're not just shipped an engine and then cast adrift as to how you're going to install it. They do provide complete firewall forward kits, and if you would key up the remainder of that video, I think Alissa covers that very well.
Okay, so over here, you can explain what is all included in your kit for the firewall forward, essentially?
Yeah, so we have a customer we're starting to pack things up for. So this is kind of an overlook of what is supplied in our kit. You have everything from the mount to the cowling, the propeller, the radiator. And we have every little bit and piece that you're really going to need for the installation, which is a lot different. We like to supply everything so our customers don't have to source for their contactors and their coolant and their batteries. So we supply everything from the bolts that go to your firewall onto the mount and everything forward from there. And we have extras and things like wiring kits to help those that don't necessarily know what gauge wire they're going to need to wire their airplane, what kind of crimpers they're going to need. So we do the best we can to help people move along in their build and not slow them down. So the more that we can supply, the better. So I guess if you want to, you can always glance over everything here, but it's kind of a basic kit that we have: our coolant, radiator, propeller, spinner, dual throttle system for this gentleman, all the plumbing, the fuel, 2.5 gallon header tank, that Jan still has to put that one together. So every little piece that we have is available, and we like to supply it all as a kit.
All right. So Jan, obviously over the years, you've done a lot of different airframes with your engines, but somebody comes to you new with something you haven't done before. What's the process of getting that customer serviced? Or
I think because of what you just said, that we have done so many, it's become real easy. Like, for instance, an engine mount. Here's a book that shows, you know, all kinds of engine mounts for different engines, different airplanes. And as you know, there's kind of like only so many firewall layouts. You have kind of the Kit Fox series of airplanes, which also is maybe like an Avid and a Highlander, and it goes on and on and on. So that kind of a shape, that width with a square bottom and the rounded top, has been done many, many times. And usually you find those firewalls on totally different airplane companies being within a half an inch of each other as far as vertical and horizontal width. So that helps. Engine mounts are very standard for what we're doing. If you're using 5/8 chromoly tubing with 060 wall, or you're using 3/4 tubing with 049 wall for certain distances, and you triangulate that good, you can very quickly, without any actual load testing, design a mount that you know is plenty strong for the airplane. So that helps. Standardization as far as the airplanes, like I said, standardization as far as always using 4130 tubing, which is the industry standard, always TIG welding. Same with cowlings. Cowling that works on one airplane might work on another one. We always save what we call the plug, which means that the plug can now be modified with minor tweaks for different airplanes, and we can make a new female mold for different airplanes. So a customer that has a scratch build or buys an old kit box or they do whatever can now get with us and supply Alissa with the dimensional, basic dimensions from drawing something on cardboard, cutting out a template or something, send it to us, and we can very quickly get a firewall forward kit together that would fit extremely well on that particular airplane.
And Jerry, do you want to talk briefly, or we can come back to the variable pitch prop, or should we do it now?
Hey, Mike, this is Steve. We do have one question in the chat. John wanted to know if the engine comes with its lifetime history. I don't know if that question was answered.
Alissa, you want to take that? Yeah.
Yeah, sure. When I kind of discussed the VIN, as far as on the side of the engine, it's that little green placard. What it does tell you is you can pull up a whole Carfax report, and a lot of times I run them. If I don't happen to have it, you know, obviously you can pull it up on your own. That way you can get it on your own, keep it in your book or whatever you want to do. And it'll show kind of how many miles it had on it when we received it or what happened or where, what state it came from. So you do know all that information based on that VIN. And a lot of times I get pictures, and if I get the pictures, I also send those to the customer as well. So they have all that readily available.
I think that pretty well answers the question. Thanks, Steve, and thanks, John. Jerry, back to pitch prop, variable pitch prop.
Yeah, and I hope you don't mind, Jan and Alissa. I did want to show the short video on your VIP.
Yeah, that's great.
And then we turn over for questions so that we've got a taste of the entire thing. So why don't you cue that up, Mike? Thanks.
We're fixing to do the first test run of the Viking variable pitch prop gearbox configuration. Jan at the controls.
We got a little bit of weather passing by, but by the time we taxi out, we'll be able to do a couple of circuits, as they say in England.
All right, well, already up.
Here we're doing a flyby. We have enough power, like 27 something RPM, wide open throttle with a lot of pitch. Alissa and Dave said it sounded like an electric motor going by. Quick test showing the amperage or lack thereof that it takes to move the propeller. A total of 1.1 amp, which is very low to move the propeller at full power. This one's pretty cool. Full throttle, maximum pitch on the prop, getting it down to 3,200, 3,300, 29 almost on the manifold pressure, 3.1 gallon and 100 miles an hour. And it is 120 miles an hour to a speed at 4,200 RPM.
What do you think?
Oh, it's a winner.
It looked like a winner. Very impressive takeoff. Great flybys.
Yeah, I've got some video at different RPMs, leaving the throttle full, and fuel flow and manifold pressure and all that. So we'll take a look at it, compile something for people to see.
Very cool. Well, congratulations. Great product. Thank you.
Hey, as we turn this over to questions, we did have a couple of follow-ons in the chat. And Alissa, the question was, as it was a follow-on to the lifetime history, John wanted to know the rev history. I assume he's talking about the RPM for specifically like red line hits, things of that nature. Can you respond to that or do you have that information?
You want to kind of tag on that? I mean, the red line of that engine is well over 7,000 RPM, and we don't even get anywhere near close to that, even in the airplane. So,
but there's no history anymore of the saved history of the original ECU that might see what the maximum RPM that particular engine ever, you know, ended up at or whatever. The good thing of these engines, of course, is they're all running in CVT transmissions, constant velocity transmissions. So that it's not, you know, you're not going to have, like a Honda Fit going around being abused as a race car or something like that. So, you know, in the history of the company, we've really never made a mistake as far as choosing an engine. You know, we choose them on how they look, we choose them on mileage, we choose them on making sure that the engine compartment had never been damaged. So, you know, the engine was always protected. Engine was always inside. We don't buy engines from up north. And in addition to all of that, the engine is the cheapest part of the whole deal. You know, you should never worry about, other than of course the safety aspect of it. But, you know, if you have, you got a real nice brand new Rotax or Ural or Continental or something, and you bust a bungee on your nose wheel and you have a prop strike, and you know, God forbid, you're out like $10,000-$15,000 by the time you're back together flying. That's not the case here. You know, that's what Alissa is saying. You know, these engines, as sophisticated and as nice as they are, they're also dime a dozen. You know, they're everywhere. And you can buy your own engine for $800 with no miles, like, you know, last year's model. So if you ever burn up the engine, you left the oil plug out, or you bust, you know, something happened to your oil filter, or a hose came off, or whatever, you're not out a lot of money if you ever had to, you know, an accident or incident like that where you damaged your engine. So I wouldn't really worry about, you know, like, well, what's time between overhaul? It's the most popular question. Well, obviously, you don't want to be overhauling it every week because that becomes a nuisance, and you don't have to. It'll last, you know, like as long as a traditional engine. But if you had something happen to it, you know, buying another core engine is not expensive. And you could then put it back together yourself or send it here or whatever. But I wouldn't put too much, you know, worry into that, you know, if the actual engine itself got damaged, because it's not expensive.
Well, and all that, just to kind of follow up on that, all that being said, like a lot of the engines, for the longest time, we had a large group of engines in here with 100 miles on them. Or even some of them much less than that. And at the same time, you know, we warranty everything. So there's, you know, if something was wrong with it, and they all run before they leave here, so it's not just kind of an unknown. There's not an unknown factor when it comes to that kind of stuff.
We're really, really big on what Alissa said about making sure that, you know, the engines were not put together in a little shop like ours. You know, we do a good job on what we do. We know our limitations. We don't have a clean room. So we're real proud of, you know, that anybody that operates our engine can feel confident that this was put together in Ohio. By the way, they're all made in the USA, in Ohio, by robotics and skilled workers at the Honda factory.
Okay, there's a, and by the way, John says thanks, but there's a follow-on or a different question in the chat, and I'll go ahead and read it. could they talk about the sensors the ECU needs, how it may integrate with the EMS? Can the ECU share data like CAN bus, or are duplicate sensors installed?
Yeah, I can do that one. That's a popular question. And certainly the, you know, there's a 9-pin DB connector off the ECU that you can plug into a laptop. You can put it into a data logger. You can fly with a data logger and it'll log every time you start and stop the engine. It'll record your flight.
Which is great for troubleshooting if you never have any issues.
Yeah, it's good for that. But as far as, you know, can you plug it into a Dynon or something like that? Technically, yes, you can. The data is available. The problem with it is, it's not really a problem. There's a pro and a con to what I'm going to tell you now. If you try to get the data log off the engine and use it for instrumentation, you will have a lot of information that you have no use for. The pilot doesn't need to know, you know, the camshaft angle. Pilot doesn't need to know the you know, a whole host of things like crankshaft sensor position and all that kind of stuff. Pilot needs to know very basic things like the temperature of the engine and the RPM of the engine and things like that. So there's more stuff coming off of the data output that is not useful and less that is useful. And there are a few things that are missing from the data output that a pilot needs. So like the engine doesn't care about oil pressure, so it doesn't have oil pressure reading. The engine doesn't care about, or the ECU of the engine doesn't care about gearbox temperature. So you that's missing. So, and then the other side of that is the stuff that a pilot needs to look at is very, very minimal. You don't have six EGTs, six CHT probes and all that kind of stuff. Liquid temperature in the block tells you everything you want to know about, you know, the temperature of the engine. So you got one probe to know what the temperature of your engine is. And then you got one for the gearbox. So you got two temperature probes and two pressure ones. You got fuel pressure, oil pressure, gearbox temperature, and coolant temperature. And that's it. And then you do get the RPM off the ECU. There's a wire that provides the you know, the pulse for the EC, for the TAC.
And any of that, any of the engine sensors and any of that stuff you need to read works really well with any engine monitoring system you want to use, from a Garmin, a Dynon, to Avolution panels, and now working with iLevel as well. So anything you want to read it on as well is also available.
So then back to the original question, do you need duplicate sensors? No, you don't. Is it a lot easier just to throw another set of sensors in because there's only two temperature and two pressures? It is. And then it's, if you use a Dynon instrument, you use Dynon sensors. You use our Viking View, you use the Viking View sensors. You use a Garmin, you use Garmin sensors.
Great, good answer. I think what we want to do is just open it up to the floor. If anyone has questions, I have a couple at the end. But anyone out there, unmute your mic and feel free to chime in and ask away.
Hey, Mike, this is Steve again. There is one more question in the chat.
Oh, sorry, I missed that one. Thanks, Steve. Okay, Jan, it says, during COVID, how do you feel about potential customer visits? For example, if someone happens to be, you know, down in Florida over the holidays.
We, you know, happen to, I mean, there's COVID and it's a terrible thing, but we have just decided to live our life the way it always was. We take precautions, we have a mask, we go into a restaurant and all that, but we haven't really, you know, done anything differently in our lives. So anybody is free to come here at any time. If they don't feel sick that day, then just walk into our shop. That's no problem.
We're completely open and we're doing demo rides and visits. And if anything, we've gotten incredibly busy during these times because people are really active with their builds right now. So everything is up and going and anybody is more than welcome to come and schedule even a demo flight in the plane and everything.
Hey, out of curiosity, from the beginning of Viking to now, how many engines have you actually shipped kind of cumulatively altogether?
It's around 1,000. We've breached that mark or neared that mark. It's 900 and something, something last time I checked. But we have a nice map on our website too that shows some of those. I'm still adding in everyday customers on maps so people can kind of generalize where they're at in the area so they can kind of get in contact with each other and stuff like that. So that's what's really, really great about it is there's a lot of camaraderie around the US because we're finding multiples and multiple EAA chapters and people even flying together and doing get togethers and stuff. So there's quite a bit.
One thing about that is, and you know, me and Alissa got married recently, we also work together, you know, 24/7, and that's been going on for many years, and that's been working wonderful. And I do get a lot of, you know, I'm a technical guy, and some people actually don't like me. And back from the Subaru days, you know, I had a lot of good Subarus that were flying, and I had people then I was learning with, and we were all learning together. And then we had the recession, and I went bankrupt, and all that. So me as Jan Eggenfellner, you'll find good things about me, and you'll find people that don't like me on the internet. Now, after the recession, we started the Viking aircraft engines, and then eventually, you know, Alissa joined that. And since the day she joined, and I could focus on test flying and building engines and designing parts and all that, and she could work with the customers and make sure everybody has everything that they want when they want it, things at Viking has turned around to the point that, and this is no exaggeration, as little as 3 years ago, we were an alternative engine. Now we've outsold the most popular engine in the Zenith line of aircraft, which is the UL engine, by 3-1. So we're no longer the alternative, which is kind of a shocker for many people. They didn't really realize how much we are actually selling and how many people find our installation videos and our helplines and all those things helpful. And then we, you know, recently, like you guys brought up the variable pitch propeller, that's the latest thing that we added. And we did that with, you know, based on experience with other propellers up through the years where empty propellers are very expensive from Germany. There are other electric propellers that are very expensive. They use slip rings. They have heavy motors and gearboxes out in the spinner. And we came up with an idea of running a shaft through our gearbox, which is nothing revolutionary, but it makes it very simple. We then timed in and worked with Duke Propellers of France, which has an all carbon fiber hub and all carbon fiber blades. So joining that together with our lightweight shaft through the gearbox and just a very simple linear actuator next to the engine, and then either just a toggle switch in the airplane or a digital controller if you must, opened up the idea that variable pitch propellers now could be used on these engines, which not necessary, but makes a huge difference on, as we have seen, the RPM ranges of these engines. There's a large or a wide range of RPM that's usable.
So I know that you've started to sell these on the vans, the RV sevens, sixes, nines. Vans is right up the road from us, and we actually host the Vans homecoming every summer. Can you talk a little bit about, beyond the RV12, some of the high performance vans and what you've done in that area?
It's not really an arena we've played too much in. If anybody knows Rans, they tend to stick with the engine options that they like. Kind of, if you start looking outside to these, you know, auto conversions and stuff, they're not the biggest fan of it, and that's just the reality. Now we have plenty of the RV12s, we have an RV9, we even have an RV6 that did something cool with our gearbox, but it's not a massive crowd or a massive seller in the RV market, no more than I think any conversions are. They really tend to stick to your typical selections. I think that is changing quite drastically as the number of inquiries that we are getting is doubling and tripling, because they're like homings and some other options out there are really pricing themselves out of the market that are making it not very feasible for people to kind of want to pick that plane with that engine. So I think it's changing, but I mean, it's something we're doing, but it's not a massive field for us.
And just to say a few more things on that, you know, I have done this my whole life as an adult life, and I want this to be fun. You know, I love going to work. I love doing this and all that. Working with Zenith Airplanes, which, by the way, was like the number one selling kit last year and the year before, is fun. The builders are fun. The builders are, the company is adaptable, you know, put any engine you want in there type of thing. The company is supportive of what we do. We hang out with them at air shows and have a margarita together. And so it's all fun. Now, the Vans crowd, the Rans crowd, lots of good people, but sitting there on a forum trying to convince someone that they should use our engine is not fun. So we have more than enough market in what we do, and that part is fun. So, but like Alissa says, and then the other side of it is, it's the truth. There hasn't been a lot of auto conversions up through the years that were actually successful. There hasn't been, you know, a 1.5 liter or a 1.8 liter or a 2 liter or whatever engine that could compete directly with a Lycoming at 75% power continuously. So it's completely true that those airplanes are more demanding than a stall airplane that, you know, you use full power for very few few seconds and all that kind of stuff. Now, that being said, I do think that it's right around the corner, like Alissa said, that, you know, like, for instance, our 1.5 with a variable pitch prop will be a perfect engine for an RB9. Lots of old goodbyes on RB6s out there. They would be perfect for one of our engines. So and like she said, the pricing on some of these clone engines and stuff, and even, you know, direct from the manufacturers are really going up in price. At the same time as old engines are getting old and, you know, will require a lot of rebuilds. So there's a lot to be said about what we do. We have not, you know, put a lot of engines in RB6s and 7s and stuff like that. I used to with the Subarus, and there was a mixed bag of success back then doing that. Now I wouldn't worry about it for a second. I think any of our engines will be just fine in those airplanes. And I'm not going to say we're not going to grow our company and get into other avenues, but, you know, it isn't fun. Like Rance, like Alissa was brought up, it's not fun to have the designer of the airplane that's been in aviation his entire life tell you that you're no good, you know? And so we have fun with what we do.
Great. I mean, that's a super answer. Again, anyone out there, because I have a whole series of questions that I can go with, but.
You gotta share, Mike. Alissa, could you give an idea on the approximate cost of, say, your 130 engine?
Yeah, our 130, and keep in mind, we have, kind of like I went over that video, we have a very complete package. So that's your fuel system, your exhaust, your propeller, your spinner, all your cooling system, your mounts, your cowlings, everything. Batteries, you know, the whole nine yards, is around 20,000 by the time you're out the door. So, and then, you know, for a lot of people, you can't even break into a horsepower engine, less horsepower, just for the engine price alone, you can't do that. So, but even more so, you know, your maintenance costs and everything are going to be drastically lower. So that's one of the great things about it. We've tried, you know, especially during COVID, a lot of things have, as far as us purchasing, has increased. They've raised their prices in all kinds of avenues, from UPS to parts and pieces and stuff, due to supply and demand. We've still continued to keep our prices low. Our biggest goal, we could raise it to $20,000, and I don't think many people would blink an eye. But the idea is to still try to keep it affordable, because I think you kind of take away that the dream of aviation from a lot of people once you start kind of just raising the price because you can. So I think that our idea is always to try to keep it as affordable as long as possible and do what we can to still maintain the business, obviously, but make it feasible for newer generations to kind of enter the market.
Thank you. I'll slip another one in before I lose the floor here. I was watching, as I said, I'd watched a number of YouTubes, and for those of you out there that want more information, there's a wealth of information out there. I did want to interject one thing. The airplane that was shown on the variable pitch short clip there was actually one that you guys re-engined. And if I remember correctly, Dave had a Corvair in it. One of the varieties of Corvair, we won't say names, and but that was actually one that you both traveled down to Texas and did an install in his hangar. Is that correct?
Yeah, we do on-site installations now. It's something we kind of, someone asked us if we would, and we just said, sure, why not? You know, we have the ability, why not? So we did. And, you know, so that came around a second time. Dave, we had been following Dave for a long time, and he's now become a really great friend of ours. And he had a crankshaft break in his Corvair within less than 100 hours. But, and he is actually, that engine is still not fixed to this day. We're talking 9 months later, he would have been grounded. We flew out the next week. We had the engine, we shipped it, we flew out the next week, we installed it in 4 days, and he was flying again. So that's what's, you know, we don't really carry a big lead time, especially for the Zenith, which he does happen to have. And we went out there and we installed it and it was done. So it's something that we offer, you know, we usually offer it, you know, for anybody that's, you know, anywhere in the US, if they, you know, fly us out there, we'll install it.
Great. Okay, now for the question. This is a technical one for Jan. Would you mind talk a little bit? It was addressed, I think, on your website, if not there, in one of the videos, the difference of this gasoline direct injection, how much more efficient that is than the typical, I guess you'd call it, intake injection.
Yeah, or port injection.
There you go. Thank you.
Direct injection, when it first came into cars, you know, it was used in the war. It had been used in radials before. It's not a new thing. There was some, you know, it's a mechanical system in the past, but it has its advantages, and now in modern days some disadvantages if it's used in a car. The car application, of course, they have to build every engine to EPA standards, and they can't just dump oil fumes from the crankcase on the ground like the old cars did. So you're forced to running your blow-by back into the intake manifold, which means this kind of oily or slightly oily air gets brought back by the intake valves, and there's no fuel being sprayed on the valves anymore because the fuel is being injected directly into the engine combustion chamber. So that's the negative that you hear, that, oh yeah, well, you at 40,000 miles, you got a, you know, walnut blast shell your intake valves. Now, luckily for aviation, we don't have that issue. So we have all the benefits without the drawback. We run a, you know, a blow-by tube overboard like every airplane engine does. And of course, being a very precise, tight tolerance engine, it doesn't have a lot of blow-by. So it's not a real issue. But if you ran it into the intake manifold over time, it could be. So that's a good thing for a direct injection and an airplane engine. So now, what are these advantages? The advantages are, if you combine direct injection with high compression and oil squirters to cool the piston bottoms and all that kind of stuff, you can increase the ignition timing dramatically in the engine, even with high compression. So you have the advantage of high compression, advanced ignition timing, and very solid knock prevention. It's very, very difficult to have knock in an engine that's direct injected, because you can also inject the fuel early in the intake cycle, which at almost, you know, elevated power, like we take out of these airplane engines, you have to do anyhow, because you don't have enough time to inject it if you inject it right before the spark plug fires, which is what they sometimes do in cars for this super lean mixtures and stuff, and getting these 50-to-1, you know, 50 miles to the gallon type of engines. We're not after that. We're after the high-end benefit of direct injection, which means we inject the fuel early as the intake valve is closed and the piston starts coming down, which is very similar to a port-injected engine, except the intake valve is closed. The advantage there is that the evaporation that takes place is of the fuel in the cylinder cools the cylinder from within. So, and now that leads to the next one, which is pumping losses. An engine has maximum efficiency with the throttle valve fully open. As soon as you start closing the throttle valve, the pistons have to pull the air through the throttle valve, which is partially open, and it's not as efficient. So now we combine that with a variable pitch propeller. So you take an engine that is almost immune to knock. You can run it with wide open throttle, which causes the least amount of pumping losses. You can run lots of ignition timing, and you use the propeller to control RPM with wide open throttle. So you're flying at wide open throttle at half engine output in cruise, and the fuel flow is drastically reduced, and the engine is completely happy with it, and you don't have to even think about the old, you know, RPM square, not too much RPM for manifold pressure and all that kind of stuff. You're maximizing manifold pressure, reducing pumping losses, and reducing fuel flow for the maximum amount of performance. And the pumping loss thing alone is like 5% right there. That's just one out of the five things I mentioned.
That's great. We have a follow-on, or a different, actually shifting gears a little bit. We have a question about the 90, and if you have some installations that would fit or have replaced VW type installations. I mean, we have a lot of low and slow stuff that we're building and working on around here. And Adrian's asking if you have some VW designs that you've used it in.
We have like the Sonics and the 701 that we both have done firewall forward and installations in. Both of them, we've got quite a few 701s flying. I think about four of them now with the 90 setup, which is our newest engine in our lineup. And then we have a Sonics that's getting ready to fly here soon as well. We have a couple builders doing that as well. So those are the two that kind of pop in my mind right off the bat. And, you know, we did some things like a RANS S12, some of the little pushers, and, you know, a CGS Hawk type of, which I think you had one that just recently sold or similar. But, yeah, so we've done a lot of the little smaller airplanes because it does have a similar weight. Anything that can basically take the weight of an Rotax 912 is a really good comparison because their all-up weight is very, very similar. If the airframe is built to handle that, then it can handle the 90.
And usually for the VW 701, it unless it's a geared or belt-driven VW engine, it really kind of turns it from a single place to a two-place airplane. If, you know, VW 701 combination on a hot day, it, you know, can be a single place airplane. But with the 90, a little bit more power and you know, more thrust, 420 pounds of thrust off the propeller, it works good in the 701 type of plane, like bush plane, like you were mentioning.
Any other questions out there?
We are
at the bottom of the hour.
How long is the gearbox life?
We have engines with well over 1,200 hours with zero issue. We've recently done one. We opened one up on a YouTube channel, actually. He had 500 hours, even had a prop strike, opened it up and showed it, and for the most part, it still looks brand new. So, I mean, if somebody wanted to, after 500 hours, just to send it in and have us look at it, if that made them feel more comfortable, yeah, we can, no problem. But the reality is we expect the gearbox to last as long as the engine, if not longer.
And gearboxes have been very reliable in the last few years. They were reliable before too, but like anything, they're mechanical devices. And we learn also over time, when we first started the turbo engine, the 195, a quart engine, it was actually a very nice thing for us. Initially, it cost us a lot of money. We had to replace some gearboxes that had already been shipped out because the gearbox was the same as the one on the 130. We then learned that we needed more support for the idler gear in the middle. We added more roller bearings, less ball bearings in that particular gearbox. And it brought us to a gearbox that could go from 130 horsepower to 195 horsepower at the same temperatures. So we learned a lot building that, and now, and then we retrofitted what we had learned on building the gearbox for the more powerful engine. And the 195 is very powerful because, like we talked about earlier, how you can run, you know, we run like 70 inches of boost in that engine, which is a lot. That's 22 pounds of boost. And so there's a lot of load on the gears all the time. And learning what we learned going through that exercise brought us to implementing that technology into the smaller engines. So they all now benefit from more strength, very little increase in weight. And that's why we have this confidence level in our gearboxes, because we know from what we've learned the last few years, you know, that the 130 that was fine for, like Alissa said, 1,200, 1,500 hours before, now is further been improved by the what we learned developing our latest turbo engine.
Well, it made sense for us to incorporate this gearbox housing and everything that was putting out 195 horsepower for stocking reasons, for pricing reasons, and for longevity reasons, just to carry it across the board to all of our horsepower. So the same for the most part, the same gearbox that you're putting on your 130 and the 90 is the same thing that's implemented on the 195, and they were going to well over 1,200 hours without issue then. So we expect them to, you know, be absolutely flawless from here on out.
Great. Hey, we have a question. Apparently people are already looking at your website. And Scott wants to know, he says that the website is no longer showing firewall forward packages. Is this something that they need to contact you, or do they have to piece together their own firewall forward kits?
It is much easier if they send me an email and I can just send them something specific to them, because a lot of people try to piece together their own thing and they're adding stuff that they don't need and picking stuff that they don't need and pricing themselves much higher than I would. So that's kind of why we stopped doing that. But firewall forward for like your 90 for almost anything, unless it's a pusher, is around 18 or 19 for the Viking 130, it's about 20, and for the 195 turbo, it winds up being 20.
And in addition to what Alyssa is saying, you know, having done this for a long time, there's also a little bit of marketing in that. And you can say it's a gimmick or not, but whatever. But what we see is if we have firewall forward packages listed on our website for $20,000, let's just say, for a 130 engine. The next thing you see is somebody takes that number and they go on a forum. And they'll say, well, I don't think I'm going to get the Viking engine. It's $20,000.
They don't understand.
And they just took the engine and everything in the kitchen sink and compared it to somebody selling just an engine for $20,000. So that's the only reason for that. That's the main reason for that.
Alissa, real quickly, I didn't hear you mentioned the price on the 195, but it was kind of garbled. What was the firewall forward kit or package on that?
By the time you're done with everything, you're a little over 30. But that's about, keep 30. In mind, that's also with a very, very pricey propeller. You know, that 5-blade propeller we use, we have other options too. So that price would only go down, not up.
Got it. Any other questions out there you want to ask before we wrap up this session?
Yes, this is Rich Paulson.
Hi, Rich.
And anyone would like to come by, I've got the 110 engine and a RV12. If anybody wants to come over, take a look at it. Viking has been just wonderful tech support over the last couple of years.
That's good to hear. And Rich, we might put you on the spot to come back and maybe give us a little program or about your progress. So thank you. Thank you very much for offering that up.
Okay, thanks.
All right. I have another technical question, Jan. Can you talk about the fuel flow in the 90 and the 130? And Jeff, I'm not sure what you have in mind there. Maybe are you talking fuel flow numbers? What are you trying to drill out?
Yeah, I'm just thinking about how it compares to some other choices in the same size engines as far as efficiency and fuel flow rate.
Consumption. fuel consumption then. Okay, yeah. There you go, Jan.
Well, you know, you're only going to get the power that depending on how much fuel you put in. So sometimes, you know, in if we're not, you know, talking marketing lingo, my idea of a successful day of test flying is if I can use as much fuel as possible. That shows me that I'm generating horsepower. And if I can generate horsepower with a Honda engine, which I know is world renowned for fuel efficiency, yet I can use fuel, I know I'm making good power. And for me, it's about tuning the engine to make the maximum amount of horsepower. You're not going to find, you know, you're not going to find a air-cooled engine that is computer controlled being capable of doing what a liquid-cooled engine can do as far as efficiency, because if you're not controlling the mixture yourself, you have to leave some fuel for cooling the air-cooled engine for safety, especially if you're going to altitude. A manually lean Lycoming is as efficient as the Honda engine at the power settings we're running. They are, you know, if you go lean of peak in a Lycoming, that's about as efficient as any engine. So, you know, you're not going to see any kind of like huge drastic decreases in fuel flow. The little clip that we saw, like if fuel flow is important, what I talked to you guys about a little while ago, which was the pumping losses and using lower RPM, lots of propeller pitch and all that, that is the absolute you know, most efficient. And there's a chart on our website, I think under specifications, and then
it's under performance. And if you go to the variable pitch propeller, it shows a lot of range of RPMs of the 130 and all the different fuel burns and where he found the most efficiency.
Yeah, if you go to performance in the second tab and then the bottom table there, yeah, this table right here, it's obviously difficult to see here, but this shows, the ones in yellow shows an airplane that has the variable pitch propeller, and as far as miles per gallon, you can see 33.6 miles to the gallon out of a Zenit airplane, you know, which traditionally is not the cleanest thing in the world. So fuel efficiency is very good.
All right. I think that probably answered your question, Jeff. All right. Let's ask, is the VIP system retrofittable?
It is. All gearboxes shipping now have the provision for a hollow shaft top gear. If somebody already has a gearbox, then yeah, it would have to come back so we could put a plate on the back in order for a seal to be installed and then run the shaft through the gearbox.
Do you have a budgetary estimate on what that option is going to run for the variable pitch?
It's about 9,000, I think, by the time you're done, between the propeller itself and the actual, which I think is about like 8,500 or something. Then we also have to have the actuator and the machine pieces that go onto the engine itself, along with the hardware to do the hollow shaft through the gear. It winds up being probably a little under 10, I think, if I remember correctly. Which if you know anything about the variable pitch propellers, most of them start out anywhere from 12 to 16,000 standard, like an Airmaster or something like that. We have similar quotes from them. And then you're also keep in mind it's a lot less complex, a lot less maintenance, and it's about half the weight of your standard variable pitch propeller.
Awesome. All right, we're going to kind of start drawing this to a close. I will entertain one or two more questions, and then we're going to wrap it up. Anyone else out there have kind of a final question?
A question I might ask is, what kind of dampener system do you separate the crankshaft on the engine from the propeller?
Yeah, we have, which has been very successful and copied by others. it's basically the same rubber damper that has an embedded rope in it, in like a donut shape, if you ever owned like a Volvo or BMW or Mercedes or anything like that, they always came with, rather than a universal joint for the main drive shaft underneath the car, they had a rubber donut type of thing at the front and one at the back. So they're designed to handle a huge amount of torque. I took that donut and kind of went a little further with it, because you do have to kind of tune the donut to the engine. So we actually have the same part number, German made, this Gibo donut that it's called, that we use on all three engines. On one engine, if you look at one of these rubber donuts, there's a fat section, a skinny section, a fat section, a skinny section, that kind of way. And there's basically three links around with six bolts. So three holes drive it, and three holes, is driven and then drive the gearbox. And there's like a spider at each end, one on the crankshaft that has three dowels that go into the donut, and then three on the gearbox that go into the other three holes. Now, rather than leaving this donut into a single piece, they get cut into three separate links from this purchased part, store purchased part. We use the heavier of the links on the 195 horsepower engine, and we use the skinnier of the links on the 130, and we actually modify them a little bit for the 90 horsepower. So they all have different tension, and we do install them in tension, so the engine is pulling the gearbox through these rubber couplings, and actually the rubber with this embedded rope that's inside of them. And lots of testing have been done with those. We've had them for many, many years. We have had plenty, for some reason, of Zenith prop strikes, at low hours. It seems to take a little bit of effort to learn how to fly these things, because they fly a little bit different. So a lot of guys plow them into the ground and with the prop first, and we basically just look at the gearbox, change the donut, and they're back flying again. So
it's a huge benefit that people also don't consider. Like, if you did that with your stereotypical any other type of traditional type engine, it doesn't have that protection, and you're looking at a rebuild over, a small mistake. Especially, it happens very, very often in the first 40 hours. Typically, they didn't do any kind of transition training or something like that. And they send the gearbox here. We can usually get it out same day. We can check everything. The engine's fine. So that helps add that extra protection and protect the engine. So it has it's a small item with a massive benefit. That sometimes gets overlooked.
Even the insurance companies like it. A lot of times the insurance adjusters will call us and say, well, this person that called us, they had a prop strike and this and that. And they're like, well, it's going to be this much to fix it. And they're like, really?
They're really happy about it. Yeah. Insurance rates actually, typically when you have just to kind of touch on this a little, a car conversion or auto conversion or whatever, you tend to have a little bit more of an issue as far as insurance. That's something we, over the past 5 years, have really had no issue with at all. In fact, we're getting better and better rates than some of your stereotypical things because of rebuild and stuff like that is, drastically cheaper. So things that are kind of well proven in the field and have quite a fleet, they're pretty happy with, insuring and doing it at lower rates.
Great, great answer. I am going to probably pull this to a close. Alissa and Jan, you have any closing thoughts? By the way, for all of our members, we have recorded this session and we will post it up on the website. I can already think of some people who weren't able to attend who would absolutely love to hear this session. But Jan and Alissa, anything you'd like to close with?
Well, I'd like to say that if you guys get bored during the COVID or it gets cold up there, we do have a really good, I think, YouTube channel. And, there's lots of things like why we do what we do, how to install the engine, and it goes on and on and on.
Yeah, and I can testify to that. I've seen a lot of those videos. And you also have quite a few good videos on your website or addressable from your website as well. Okay, let's kind of pull this to we'll call it a wrap. And I really want to thank Jan and Alissa for volunteering to do this, and Jerry for helping put together some of the materials as well. You know, these are the kinds of sessions that I think we get a lot of value out of. And you guys are down in Florida and we're up here in Oregon. And perhaps we don't have the same popularity of your engines up here that maybe you have down in the Southeast and other places, other areas of the country. So the other thing is, we would certainly, any time that you find yourselves in the great Northwest, especially in our wonderful summers, we'd love to have you come in, maybe present in person, bring an aircraft in, or anything else in any way we could help you. We can put you up here at the air park, no charge. We'd love to have you as guests. So that invitation is absolutely extended. All right.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Jerry, for helping out as well. I really appreciate it. And you guys enjoy the rest of your weekend.
I appreciate that. Thanks a lot for your time. And hopefully we'll see you at an upcoming air show or something, or here next summer. Okay.
Bye, guys. Bye, everybody. Thank you.
Thanks, John.
All right. All right. For the rest of the chapter members still hanging on, let's call that a wrap. I want to wish everyone a Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays. And we're really, really looking forward to getting back together. It sounds like from where we're at right now, January looks like another video meeting. But believe me, we are going to break out of this as quickly as we feel like we safely can. Also putting a plug in for Dwight Hoover's session in January. You've heard about the Viking now, and we've heard about some other engines along the way, Corvairs and so forth. And now you're going to hear about the Yamaha Apex, which is lighter in weight and higher in output, but a little more effort to implement and to integrate. So I think you'll find that really, really interesting. And with that, let's call it a day. Thank you for everyone who participated and called in, and have a great holiday. And we'll be talking with you and seeing you next month. All right. Take care now.